All That Stuff on BCTV is supported by the Renaissance Auction Group.
Hello, friends, and welcome to the August 2023 episode of All That Stuff. Tonight, we're going to have one of our Helpful Hints from Bill show, which things that you can put to use, hopefully, in your collecting, in your buying, in your selling. You know, sometimes we talk about philosophical and esoteric things like we did last month about what you can and can't sell at auction or should sell at auction or shouldn't sell at auction. And sometimes we do our interview shows, and sometimes we just help you learn more about the buying or selling at auctions. But tonight, this is something that has to do with just helping you if you are either a buyer, a seller, a collector. And the show tonight will be on identifying art. Eye of the beholder, identifying art. One of the issues that often comes up, oftentimes I get phone calls and people will say, you know, I've got a painting. And I say, okay, do you know for sure it's a painting? Well, no, I don't. I say, all right, can you describe it to me a little bit? Well, when they do, sometimes what they have is a painting, sometimes what they have is a print, sometimes what they have is an original work of art, but it's not technically a painting. So people have a lot of time, you know, a lot of challenges identifying the genre of the art that they own. And then, once again, I was on the Auctioneer Facebook page and somebody posted and said, and they put up three pictures and they said, I have these three items, what are they? And there were a variety of answers, most of which were, you know, somewhat correct or maybe partially correct, but not completely correct. And then I realized that something that I had learned over my 30 or 40 years of dealing with auctioneers, 41 to be exact, only about 45 of dealing with auctioneers, but 40 years of being in the profession, 41 years of being in the profession, is that a lot of times, if you don't handle art on a regular basis, then it can be very difficult to determine exactly the type and genre of art, which of course is important. It's important if you're trying to sell it yourself, let's say. Maybe you're a reseller, maybe you have joined the legions of resellers that have emerged with internet commerce. Maybe you're a buyer. If you're a buyer, ideally you know what type of genre of art that it is that you prefer or that you're looking for, but you may or may not. Or you may see a piece of art and say, you know, I like that, but I wonder what it is. And then it's, and you're hoping that the person that's selling it can accurately identify it. So what tonight's show is about is simply simple tips for helping you get in the ballpark. It's not about, we're going to talk about original works of art, and we're going to talk about reproduced works of arts. And in this case, when I say reproduced, the more common term is prints. I don't necessarily mean modern reproductions necessarily. They may be pieces that are decades or several hundred years old, but they are still reproduced pieces of art because they are multiple copies made of an original piece of art. Generally speaking, generically, we refer to those as prints. But all prints are not created equal, as we'll see tonight. And when we go through this show, it would take probably 10 shows to try and describe what each kind of print was and how it was made in the process. And I'm not sure it would have that much meaning or would interest too many people. So this is all about practical tips of figuring out what type of genre of art are you looking about. And along the way, of course, as we always do, we'll add little tidbits here and there that not only help with identification, but perhaps about care and otherwise. So let's start first with a rundown of original art. By original art, we mean pieces that are unique, that have been created by hand, that have not been reproduced either by hand or by machine, and they are one-offs. So probably the most common thing, once again, people call me up all the time and say, I have a painting. So we have paintings. We have watercolors. I'm sure many, and if not most of us, are familiar with watercolors. We also have original works of art that are done in charcoal, pastel, or crayon. Pen and ink drawings have been around for hundreds of years. Pencil drawing and sketches, the same, you know, ever since there were pencils. It's very convenient to work with a pen and ink, and with particularly with pencils, because you can carry them around quite easily and you can use them on a variety of substances. And then we have mixed media, which is collage, assemblage, and found art, which we're not going to go into tonight, but which I wanted to mention to you as an area of original art. And we're going to go through these one at a time and talk about some tips for identifying. All right, let's start with paintings. You might recognize this as a Thomas Aikens painting that we sold back in late January, early February. When you're looking at a painting, basically if it's before the 1940s, 50s, or 60s, you're looking at oil paints applied to a substance. The most common one we think of is canvas. So there on your left, you see a Thomas Aikens painting dated 1909. But on the right-hand side, you see the back. Now, generally speaking, some things to remember about paintings is, first of all, most paintings do not have glass. Most paintings are not covered in glass, and they are not recommended to be covered in glass for a variety of reasons. But also, paintings on canvas. In order to paint on a canvas, you have to pull it across a stretcher, okay? That's what that frame is that you see on the right-hand side. That's known as the stretcher. Generally speaking, even when a painting is put in a frame, it does not have glass, as I told you, but oftentimes it does not have a backing either. Sometimes a backing board is put in to protect the back of the canvas from damage. Sometimes it is sealed with paper just to keep out dust and dirt, and also to add a certain element of protection. For instance, if the painting were to be bumped against something sharp, it wouldn't go right through the canvas. But oftentimes in oil on canvas, really most oftentimes, you will be able to turn it around and you will be able to see the canvas, okay? That's the key, one of the keys for identifying whether you have a painting or not. Once again, you can have a painting with glass, but if it doesn't have glass, if you flip it around and you see that stretcher and you see that canvas cloth-like material there, the back of it, then you pretty much know you have a painting. Now, there's a few caveats, and we'll get to that toward the end under reproduced paintings, but that's one of the key ways to identify a painting. So if you see glass on the front and you flip it around and it's sealed on the back, then you know that the chances are high that you're not looking at a painting, that you're looking at some type of other either original work of art or a reproduced printed work of art. All right, now this is a Victor Scherer from the famous Scherer family of Berks County. I showed you this one because, once again, you see the painting in the top left. It does not have glass on it. And you see the stretcher in the bottom right, and you see the canvas. But what I really want to show you here is notice the difference in aging in those two canvases. Now, what's interesting is the first one is about 103 years old, but the second one is almost 75 years old. What caused that? Well, it could be any number of things. It could be any type of treatment that was done to the back of the canvas that may have changed its color. Most likely, it is the interaction of light and oxygen on the canvas, what we call a patina. But it's also probably, to some degree, how and where it was stored or how it was stored. The one we're looking at now, the Thomas Aikens, probably was stored at some time in an area that allowed more direct access of light to the back, or of light or of air to the back of the canvas. Now, this Victor Scherer, if you look at it, the canvas doesn't look much different than a 20-year-old painting. So in this case, most likely, the back was not exposed directly to sunlight as much, as often, if at all. It looks like it was. So what are we thinking there? Well, it's probably hung on the wall its entire life. You know, it probably stayed on the wall its entire life so that the sun did not ever hit the back of the canvas. All right, and here's a third example. It is signed JDL, which was an unidentified artist. This is a cubist example, probably from the 1940s, early 1950s. Once again, you can see the stretcher there, and you can see the little wedges that are used to tighten that canvas across that stretcher once it has been stretched so that it stays truly taut. For both display and painting purposes. And you can also see in this case that most likely this was an art student. It shows some ability in the execution that most likely they were an art student and maybe they were reusing canvases. One thing to remember about canvas has never been cheap. Even by today's standard, it's not cheap. It used to be extremely expensive by virtue of other painting mediums, art board, a board itself, actual wood boards, paper. So artists tended to parcel out their canvases and reuse their canvases, and that was particularly true of artists who maybe were not that flush with cash, who were the quintessential starving artist. So now here's a little thing we'll talk about paintings too. This is a painting by an individual named Granville Fisher. It dates from the late 60s. It has a mass-produced Mexican frame that was cheap at the time, but has actually become rather trendy as part of the mid-century modern mystique. What's different about this painting that you can't tell here on the slides from the other three that I just showed you is that this is acrylic on canvas as opposed to oil on canvas. Acrylic paints were bought in starting in the 1940s, but they became very popular in the 1950s, 60s, and 70s for a number of reasons. They were easier to use, they were quick drying, and they were cheaper than oils. So just like canvas was expensive, oil paints were expensive. And they required a lot of mixing agents, drying agents, et cetera, depending on what you wanted to do with them. Whereas acrylics were the modern post-World War II invention. So if you're looking at a painting that's after 1940, 50, or 60, the odds go up dramatically that you're looking at acrylics. What are some of the characteristics? Acrylics, once again, they dry faster, but as far as the appearance, acrylics have, when they dry, have a naturally duller sheen to them. You know, they have a duller appearance than oils, which always have kind of a more gloss finish to them. Acrylics have more of a matte finish. Now, there are agents you can add to acrylics to give them a higher sheen and to make them look more like oil. In general, if you were looking at the entire history of painting, oil on canvas is still considered the crown jewel of art. You know, acrylics on canvas have become more and more accepted for obvious reasons because more and more people use them these days, and many very accomplished contemporary artists use acrylics and prefer acrylics. But in the ranking of value, taking everything even, in other words, if the same artist did an oil on canvas and acrylic on canvas, generally speaking, the oil on canvas would be more valuable if they were of the same level of execution. By the same token, if a very well-known, respected, and noted artist had acrylic on canvas and a lesser-known, lesser-respected artist had oil on canvas, then of course acrylic on canvas would be more valuable. So when you're looking at original works of art on canvas, you're usually looking at oil on canvas or acrylic on canvas. And remember, acrylics only came into the 1940s and only became widely used in the 1950s and 60s. And it really, they grew in popularity. So even in the 50s and 60s, you had a lot of a top-tier artist using only oil on canvas. All right, now the thing is, you know, whether you're using oils or whether you're using acrylics, canvas isn't the only thing you can put them on. As a matter of fact, canvas is the most expensive, generally speaking, of the backing substances that you can paint on. So many artists either out of expense or out of because they didn't want to have to prepare the canvases and stretch the canvases, they used what was known as artboard. Artboard is basically a hardback board that has either a thin layer of canvas pulled over it, manufactured that way, or has some type of material made to imitate the surface of canvas, you know, where it's coated with it, so that it appears to be canvas. But generally speaking, it was a thin layer of canvas, and that's known as artboard. You will see a lot of examples on artboard. You will see them by noted artists who were simply working, but necessarily weren't painting their masterpieces. You'll see them by all levels of regional and local artists. This is by an artist named Charlotte Dennis, who had connections to Pottsville and to New Jersey. She had some skill, and her paintings show an element of a professional execution, but almost everything she did was on artboard. So you've got acrylics, and you've got oils, you've got canvas, and you've got artboard. Now here's another Cubist painting, almost certainly by the same artist, although this one was not signed, but it wasn't on canvas, and it wasn't on artboard, it was on Masonite. What was Masonite? Masonite was basically a hardback board that was the precursor of sheetrock. It was used a lot in construction. And in this case, this artist, probably once again who was a student, said, well, you know, I've got some Masonite here. I think I'll just use that. And if you were to put the canvas and the canvas example and the Masonite example together by the same artist, they both show very similar skill level, and they were both very attractive works of art. We sold those also in this past late January, early February, 2023. I think the skill level, the execution, and the overall appearance of the work on canvas was more attractive, and maybe the artist knew that as well. Maybe that's why they put that one on canvas, and maybe that's why this one was on Masonite, because this was more of a study or a practice piece. All right, original works of art. Charcoal, this is actually to some degree a mixed media because it is charcoal and pencil. This is by Alice Barber Stevens. She was a local, i.e. Philadelphia, a regional artist. She was a student of Thomas Aikens, and she was a famous and well-known illustrator in her own right in the early 20th century, late 19th century. This is one we sold about 3 or 4 years ago. This was an original sketch, pencil, charcoal and pencil sketch, charcoal, pencil, and colored pencil sketch by Alice Barber Stevens. Illustrators, you know, back before photography, one of the ways that working artists made a living was to illustrate magazines, books. Many, many famous artists, Maxfield Parrish, R. Atkinson Fox, Norman Rockwell, just any number of artists fed their families and made their living by being illustrators from the early 19th century through until really probably right before World War II or right after World War II, when photography became so popular, and then color photography, which allowed magazines and books to use photographs if they chose to. There was still a place for illustration, and you know, the vast majority of children's books are illustrated to this day. But this is an original work of art. It's charcoal, it's pencil, and it's colored pencil. And she was doing this as part of a fashion book that she was illustrating at the time. All right, this is an original charcoal. This is Linda Hoyer, who was John Updike's mother. John Updike, the famous author, 20th century author with roots right here in Reading and in Berks County. His mother was Linda Grace Hoyer. This came from her estate. This was part of an auction that we did last year. And this is an original charcoal. One of the things that you need when you're looking at art is you need two things for sure. You need a loop, a jeweler's loop, a magnifying glass. You know the little magnifying glasses you can carry around in your pocket that you can put up to your eye and it magnifies. And then it also helps to have a magnifying glass, a good quality magnifying glass. And in today's market, I would recommend the ones that have lights where you can just flip a switch on them. They either run off a AA battery, some of them are rechargeable, and there is a light that shines underneath the magnifying surface. Those two tools are key to identifying art. What would you be looking for? Why would you be using them here? Why would you be using them in original paintings or in the Alice Barber Stevens? When you look, no matter how good your eyes are, unless you're very experienced in the first place, which maybe, you know, then you wouldn't be listening for these tips, right? Because you'd already know them. With the naked eye, it's very difficult to see the elements that are necessary to make a solid identification, a definitive identification. In this charcoal, what you would be looking for is you would be looking for the movements, the equivalent of the brush strokes and the streaks that charcoal make, and you would be looking for the absence of the artifacts that are on printed works. And we'll get into that in a little bit when we get into printed works. So you're looking for two things. You're looking, can I see actually the chalk and the different varying levels where the artist was applying them in one way? Notice technique used for the skin on the face would have been different than the technique used in the hair, and different than the technique used in the ground, and different than the technique used on her coat, sweater, whatever she's wearing there, over her top dress there. So when you look at that with a magnifying glass, you can see. You can say, okay, I can see. I can actually see where the work of the artist and the movement of the artist and the lack of pressure or the more pressure of the artist leads me to believe that this is original work of art. Now, going with charcoals, almost always you're going to find charcoals on some form of paper. There's all kinds of paper. There's laid paper. There's all kinds of stocks of paper. But generally speaking, charcoal is going to be applied to paper. It is rarely applied to canvas. Might be applied to artboard oils and acrylics. Almost always are going to be applied to either canvas or artboard or masonite or even wood. You know, just plain old wood, particularly if you get into folk art, which we have talked about before over the years in our All That Stuff episodes. And when you get into 19th century art, sometimes people who had artistic skill, they were not either professionally trained artists, nor were they living in places where they had easy access to canvas. And so they would use the materials that they had in order to still be able to apply their artistic skills and to satisfy their artistic instincts. Pen and ink. Pen and ink has been around as long as there were pens and inks. Generally speaking, you're going to find pen and ink on paper. It's not going to be on wood. It's not going to be on canvas. It's not going to be on hardboard. It's going to be in any number of types of paper. Paper can be made out of a number of substances. And once again, paper can have a number of textures. It can have a number of bondages, just like the paper that you buy for your printer is normally 20 bond. But if you're doing a hand bill, you might buy 50 bond. So there are different delineations, both bonds and other terms, that denote the characteristics of paper, not only their thickness and their heaviness, the texture on the paper, etc. Pen and inks are almost always going to be on paper. They're in 20th century on, you will find multicolored pen and inks, but generally antique and vintage pen and inks are going to be in black and white for the most part. Another thing you're looking here, you're going to look up in the top left here and you're going to see a signature up there. It actually has a date as well. This is another thing that you're examining when you're looking at all these original works of art. If they are signed, you're looking at the signature to see if the signature really appears to actually have been placed there by hand or whether it is a printed signature. And once again, when we get to the artifacts that you can look for in printed items, it will become more clear and you'll get the final tip. But you're looking, for instance, in this pen and ink, you're looking to see, does this look like somebody actually signed it? Is the pressure, even though the pressure may change a little bit in a person's natural signature, it does. Does it look like there is a fluid, solid line without any gaps, unnecessary or unexplained gaps in the signature, and also without, by gaps, I mean gaps in the actual substance that was used to apply the signature, if it was ink or if it was paint, you know? Or am I seeing little dots where it seems like the color is missing? Well, you know, nobody signs their signature and then stops with them and leaves a little dot off and then starts again and leaves a little dot off. That's a classic characteristic of a printed signature. So the signature is another key piece for identifying an original work of art versus a printed work of art. This is another pen and ink. By the way, that first pen and ink was mid-19th century. This is an early 20th century pen and ink. Notice also that it's black and white, basically, you know. Pen and inks were are appreciated by people because of the level of detail a good artist can impart to a pen and ink drawing. You know, you can be much finer in your lines with the tip of a pen than you can with the tip of a paintbrush, unless you're an extremely accomplished artist with paintbrush. Pencil drawings. You know, I really like art of all types and mediums, you know. Once again, if we use the term, when I use the term medium, plural being media, that is the substances that are used to create the illustration or to create the work of art. Oil is a medium. Acrylic is a medium. Pen with ink is a medium. A pencil is a medium. You know, this is the substance that was used to create the work of art. Pencil drawings, I think, have a very warm kind of feeling. Once again, they are good because a pencil, much like a pen, not quite as much, but the same as a pen, can make much finer lines. They often are used when you are striving more for realism. You know, although I've seen some very good pen and inks, and I've seen some very good pencil drawings where you had more of an abstract or more of an impressionistic look, but they're basically more, and that's why they're usually referred to as drawings or sketches. Pen and ink drawings, pen and ink sketches, pencil sketches. Because they are usually used for more realistic depiction of a scene or a subject matter. Watercolors. Watercolors are a wonderful medium. Artists like them because they are simpler, they are easier, they offer a lot more variety with a lot less effort than oils or acrylics. A watercolor paper is more available and cheaper for the most part, unless you're using really high-end watercolor paper. And there are so many different types you can create so many different types of artistic styles. You know, realism, impressionism. Yeah. And there's an artist from down in Lancaster County. His name's just escaping me right now. I've sold quite a few examples of his. You can't find anything about him now. He just disappeared, it seems, you know, maybe about 10 or 15 years ago. Jeff Martin is his name. When you look at his watercolors, they are incredibly realistic. You would think that you were looking either at a print or at a painting. That's generally not the case. You can see this. Usually with watercolors, you can see that kind of washing of the edges. You can look, once again, with a loop. It's very easy to distinguish a watercolor from a painting or a pen and ink or a pencil drawing. It's, you know, if you're not familiar with them and you don't know anything about them, you can look at them and you can see watercolors, quite obviously, are water-based paints, and they tend to flow, the lines tend to flow into each other. This one is by James M.K. Waldron, who is a well-known Berks County artist. He was a professor of art at Kutztown University, and his work is always very popular, and he did a lot of local scenes and things like that. This is another local artist who is no longer living. His name is Elizabeth Seidel. This is her depiction of Galen Hall. This is her watercolor depiction of Galen Hall. If you've ever watched a watercolor artist work, a really adept watercolor artist, they can sometimes turn a really nice watercolor out in an hour and a half. It's a medium that lends itself to working quickly and to efficient use of time. Now, that doesn't mean you can't take a lot of time on a watercolor. It doesn't mean a lot of watercolor artists don't take a lot of time. But it is also a medium that if you become adept at it and if you become familiar with it, you can create very interesting and desirable works of art in a relatively short period of time. By the same token, in the art world, watercolors rank significantly down in value from some of the other medium. Okay, this is Jackie Muth, also a Berks County artist. One nice thing about watercolors is you can have more muted colors or you can have very vibrant colors. Jackie Muth was known. She also did work on canvas as well, but she is known for very, very vibrant colors in her watercolors and a lot of floral still lifes that are actually quite striking. All right, so there's some of our original forms of art. That's, once again, I left out for this, for the purposes here, I left out mixed media and collage and found art because those, are, even though they're original works of art, the ability to identify them is significantly different, and usually they won't fool you. Somebody won't call you up and say, I have a painting, when they really have a found art object. So this show is about helping you identify these pieces and works of art that you are likely to come across. So I'm using the term reproduced art here. The more common term is prints. But when I say reproduced art, you know, in the antique and collectible world, the word reproduction kind of is a diminishment of value and a diminishment of desirability. That's not the case here. All prints are reproduced copies of the original work, and that's what I mean when I'm using the term reproduced prints here. Printmaking has been going on since the 800s and 900s AD. Much of our early printmaking skills were developed in China, Japan, India. But the prints have followed the course of human technology and human history as far as the techniques. Once again, tonight we're not going to talk about printmaking techniques because that could go on and on and on. Very interesting. You know, what's the difference between how they create an etching and how they create a steel engraving? But if you're that interested, that's something that you really need to go study yourself because each one of their entire books on the process for creating each one of these prints. Each one is very detailed and there's a high level of skill. Many times you have several entities working. You have the artist, and then you may have the etcher, you may have the publisher and the printer. So there's a lot of moving parts in printmaking. We're going to start out first with, these are two terms that are often misused. First, I'll go down the list for you. There's woodcuts and woodblocks. Those two are often confused. They are used as interchangeable words when in fact they are not. There are etchings. You know, you've always heard, well, would you like to come upstairs and see my etchings? Steel engravings, lithographs, probably the most common form in modern era from 1850s and 60s on. The lithograph was first developed in the last decade of the 18th century. But from, say, 1850, 60 on, as not surprisingly, particularly in our country and in Western Europe, as the mechanical age and the industrial age went into full blossom, then printmaking, the options on printmaking, and the colors you could use, and the number of prints you could make at the cost per unit went down dramatically. And that's when the heyday of lithographs, we still see lithographs today. There's multiple forms of lithographic printing. You have silk screens, you have serigraphs, which are silk screens in disguise. You have watercolor prints, and the reason I put watercolor prints in here, we'll get to that, because I want you to, from an identification standpoint, there's one thing I want you to know them. And then you have a very contemporary form known as a giclée. Let's start with woodcuts. This is an Albrecht Dürer woodcut from the early 1500s. Woodcuts and woodblocks are two forms of printmaking where the actual subject matter is done in relief as opposed to intaglio. Now, what do I mean by that? Relief is when the portion of the artwork that you want to reproduce is raised up off the surface. It's raised above the surface. We might refer to it in other terms as embossing. For instance, we're going to have a vintage and antique beer bottle collection coming up. The term there for that raised printing that you saw on beer bottles and raised trademarks was embossing. So relief, emboss, they are related terms. But the part of the printing plate, in this case the wood block, which is the printing plate, the part that the artist is creating to make the image that they want to impart is raised above the surface as opposed to cut in the surface. So both woodcuts and wood blocks are relief forms of art and relief forms of printing. All right, Albrecht Dürer, we've had woodblock printing since the 800s or 900s in Oriental parts of the world. About the mid-1400s in the Occidental part of the world, when it came to Europe, Albrecht Dürer was one of the earlier producers of woodblock prints. You'll notice that you can see the lines in them. You can see the lines in them. You know, at that time, they were exclusively black and white. Now I'm going to take you to a woodblock print that has a little story behind it. This is from an early 1970s album by the mayor of Marlborough Street, Dave Van Ronk, the fine traditional folk artist Dave Van Ronk. This was done by a gentleman named Luke Faust, who I knew personally. I had the album in my collection, and then one day I met Luke Faust, who was hanging out with Fly Breedenberg and Stephen Jacchetti, who later became known as the musician Stephen James, in an upstairs in Jonesboro, Tennessee, and they had a little music shop, and they were selling all kinds of interesting music that I was already in the habit of buying. Joseph Spence, the Bahamian guitarist, and Skip James, and the Reverend Gary Davis. And I happened to have this Dave Van Ronk, Songs for Aging Children album. And Luke said to me, he said, you know, I did that cover. I did that woodblock on the cover. I said, really? He said, yeah. He said, just flip it over and look. I looked over, and sure enough, on the back cover, it said woodblock, Luke Faust. Very interesting gentleman. He ended up staying for a while with us on my parents' farm down there in Nebraska. This was around 1974. But this is a woodblock print of Dave Van Ronk from the late 20th century. And once again, you can see, you know, I chose this one because it had a special meaning to me, but because it was in color, you know, because this is probably a lithographic printing of a woodblock print, you can see the lines and you can see how woodblock prints are constructed. And you're going to see that in about any woodblock print. You can see it in the Albrecht Dürer as well, it's just that you can't see it as well, maybe unless you have your 65-inch television going there. These are woodblock prints, and you can see they look distinctly different from woodcut, right? The grand exhibitors, the great masters of woodblock prints are Chinese and Japanese, and almost exclusively Chinese and Japanese, with a few examples here and there. What is the difference in a woodblock and a woodcut? Now, both of them are using wood plates, and they're both done in relief. But the ancient art of woodblock printing, which began really around 1000 AD in China and Japan, the best way to describe it is the woodblock would be imprinted on a piece of paper, and it would look about like a coloring book. And then the artist would go in and they would add the color between the lines. And as they did so, they became more and more and more skilled, not only in composition and the very kind of mystical compositions that you associate with so much Oriental art, antique Oriental art, but they became masters of applying different levels of color and mixing these colors so that they were extremely vibrant. Well, of course, in the Western world, because the Orient was mystical and unusual and a faraway place in very ancient cultures, there was always an allure starting as, you know, in Europe as soon as there was a market for imported goods, and the same in the United States. As soon as there was a market for imported goods, there was always a lure of the Orient, and there was always a fascination with Oriental styles and compositions. So the woodblock print is, they're exceptional. The best are exceptional. The best are very expensive. Notice in the top left, you're going to see two things. One of those is likely the title, and one of those is the artist mark. Sometimes they're called the printer's block. Some of them can be the printer's block, but usually there's three if that's the case. And there's a printer's block because in the art of woodblock printing, the printer played a critical role in the final result. It wasn't just the artist. It wasn't like someone painting where the artist does it all, you know. No. In order for the print to be reproduced so that you could have more than one, and so that maybe you could have 100 or 200 or 300 or 500 or 1,000, then the role of the printer was extremely important. Okay, here we have etchings. Now, you've always heard of etchings. One of the ways, once again, practical thing here, is one of the things about etchings, and it's going to be true of steel engravings, is they are done on plates, once again, except in the case of etchings, this showed the movement of technology, even though etchings began in the 1400s and 1500s. They were generally etched on copper plates in the beginning because copper was a malleable metal. Now, this was an intaglio form of printmaking. The lines were cut into the copper plate as opposed to the relief or bas relief of woodcuts and wood blocks. But the block of the print, meaning the outline there, is almost always visible. You know, so you see this kind of definite border or boundary. That's one of the elements of most etchings. Etchings initially were generally bichrome, you know, black and white, black and tan. Over time, they became hand-tinted etchings, and then ultimately they were able to actually come up with polychrome printed etchings. But by that time, etchings themselves had become much less popular art form. So in this case, they were cutting into a copper plate. Those copper plates were sometimes good for 200, 300, 400 maybe copies, and then they had to be re-etched. So there was a limitation. But one of the benefits is, just like pen and ink original drawings, the lines could be much, much finer. Now, how do you tell an etching from, say, a woodcut or from a steel engraving? Well, the etching is going to have more of a flow like the woodcut does, but it's generally going to be absent the overall polychrome effect of woodcuts. And when you look at it through your magnifying glass and through your loop, you're going to see that when there is color in etchings, it's almost always hand applied. That means the etching was printed and then it was hand colored. And in that hand coloring, you can begin to see the same type of irregularities you would see in original work of art, because the tinting itself and the hand coloring is an original application to the printed etching. So that's one of the ways that you can begin to tell etchings. The other is look for the border. The third way is you generally are going to have only a black applied to a colored ground, whatever that color might be, whether it be white or whether it be cream or off-white. You're going to see the fine lines when you look through it with a loop, and you're also going to see the lines that were left that where the color went into the plate. Once again, you can't see that well in this type of presentation, but that's what you will see with your magnifying glass. Another etching. This is an etching by the famous Spanish artist Goya from the mid-19th century. And once again, see, now you can begin to see the lines there. You can see that those are the lines that come off the plate. Now, some of those are put in there purposely to denote texture are to denote a type of substance, be it stone or wood, but some of them are the artifact of the etching process itself. All right, a third example of etchings right here, and once again, you can see now when you're looking here, you can see you get more of a sense of a painting as opposed to this. Now, this is a steel engraving. Steel engravings were developed at about the same time as the lithograph, the last decade of the 1700s, but the process for the lithograph took much longer to get to full color lithographs. In this case, this is what's called a steel engraving. As steel engravings went from there, they were popular really for only about 60 or 70 years, but they gave great detail and almost photographic realism, okay? Now, here's another steel engraving from a later period. Notice how this one is getting even more realistic because as the process went on, they were able to make the lines finer and finer and finer in the steel engravings. Once again, an intaglio form of printmaking. The lines were cut into a steel plate. Now, what do I mean by the lines? And this is the key about identifying steel engravings, and you will need your loupe or your magnifying glass. There are the lines if you looked at them under high magnification. You can see where the lines were cut into the plate. Now, I won't go into, and I don't have time because I'm already running out of time, to how the colors were applied and how the actual image was created. But you can see the lines there. And if you were to look with magnification to either one of these steel engravings, you would see those same lines. You know, they're not always straight. Oftentimes they can be curved because as the process was developed more and more and as the ability to cut into that steel was developed and enhanced, then they became more and more realistic and they became more and more the skill level increased. Once again, by about they started in early 1800s, and by 1860s, lithographic printing had pretty much replaced the steel engraving. If you find a colored steel engraving, once again, they were generally hand-tinted. It was engraved just as you see it, and then color was added with hand-tinted coloring. All right, the lithograph. The lithograph, the most common of the printmaking processes that we normally encounter. There are numerous lithographic processes that have changed since it was first developed in the last decade of the 1800s all the way up through today. This is a polychrome lithograph where they learned how to add multiple colors through a variety of processes. This is a black and white lithograph by an artist named Stowe Wingenroth from the 1930s. He worked a lot with the Works Progress Administration and the Arts Project, the FAP, which was to employ artists during the Depression and to promote American art and to preserve American history, art, and music. He was a very well-known lithographer. In this case, he worked almost exclusively in black and white. He did a lot of the Hudson Valley and the Maine coast. This is a contemporary lithograph. This is contemporary lithograph, Mount Vernon in the moonlight. It's called Mount Vernon in the Moonlight. Now I want to show you this. I've put this composite together. On the top there, you have an artist mark. You know, some artists use a mark or a trademark. You have the pencil signature of Paul McGeehy, who was the artist. And in the middle, if you look at the middle top right where the gray section is, you'll see the numbering, 211 over 2000. Signed and numbered prints, particularly in 20th century, late 19th century, that's one of the ways you know it's a print that is not an original work of art. 211 over 2000, what does that mean? That means that was the 211th print to go through the press at that run, and there were 2,000 total. You will also see both steel engravings and lithographs. You often see them a print title. They may be pencil titled, pencil signed, and pencil dated, or they may be print titled, pencil signed, or they may be, you know, any combination of those can happen, but generally with a print, you can have prints that, inexpensive prints are generally just print signed. In other words, the artist signed the original, and then they just printed his signature inside of the image, you know. But, of course, the more desirable lithographs are the ones that are signed, actually signed by the artist. The artist sits down and signs all 2,000 of them. He may use pen, he may use pencil. Pencil is the most common. Those are known as pencil titled, pencil signed, pencil numbered. You'll see a couple more here. This is Paul Landry. We sold a lot of his work. He is a artist from Cape Cod area. Does a lot of Americana style paintings. You will probably recognize this individual, P. Buckley Moss, who does a lot of paintings of Amish and Mennonite culture. Once again, there on the left, you see the P. Buckley Moss pencil signs. You see the date on the right, you see the numbered part of it. Sometimes she will also pencil title her work. These are all forms of lithograph prints, okay? This is a silk screen. Now, people think silk screens, does that mean it's on silk? Well, no, not really. That's not how it originally started out. It originally started out because first they used human hair to make a fine mesh and then press the color through onto the accepting surface, whether it was paper or whether it was cloth. Oftentimes it was cloth, and oftentimes in the Orient it was silk. So that's how they actually got the name silk screen. But then again, they started having silk room dividers that were silk screens. So people started saying, oh, that's a silk screen. Well, yeah, it is a silk screen, and it actually has a silk screen technique to apply the decoration to them. But it's two different types of silk screens. But in this case, this is a late 18th century Korean silk screen. This is a 19th century Japanese silk screen. This is a silk screen by the artist Amedeo Modigliani. Now, who died relatively unknown and penniless, but whose work has now become incredibly expensive, using different versions of the same process. This is a silk screen, and is actually at this point it becomes a serigraph, because in the 1930s, silk screens are the same thing that we make t-shirts. T-shirt designs are silk screens. But in the 1930s, artists said, hold on, we don't want to be associated with these modern forms of silk screening that began in the early 20th century where you could mass produce and put silk screens on anything. We want these to be known as works, works of art, so they became known as serigraphs. This is Andy Warhol, one of the famous, most famous contemporary promoters of silk screen. And this is Peter Max, another famous in our culture, famous promoter of silk screen. Notice the vividness of colors that somebody like Peter Max can get with this method of using a fine mesh and pressing the color through to the accepting ground. All right. Now, once again, these are serigraphs. This would be a serigraph, except Modigliani died before they started calling them serigraphs. So, in this case, it's a silk screen. That's a serigraph. This is a serigraph. This is Leroy Neiman, another famous artist of the time, using the serigraph. They're basically another term for silk screen. This is a serigraph. Notice how much realism and tone and things you can get in this form of printmaking as well. I put these in. This is a print of a watercolor, and I put these two in for you for two reasons. Even with your loupe and even with your magnifying glass, you're going to have a hard time sometimes telling the best print watercolor prints from original watercolor. So just be aware of that. You may even have to take the object apart. You may even have to take the object apart to before you can begin, because unlike so many other forms of printmaking, when you look at them closely, you can see that they are printed, or they have giveaways like pencil titling and stuff. With a watercolor print that is not pencil signed or pencil titled, it can be one of the most difficult things to tell just from looking through the glass. Okay, these are called giclées. Giclées didn't come around until the last part of the 20th century. It was basically initially started out being done when the inkjet printer became popular. It was a different form of printing prints using inkjet printers. They now have what they call giclée printers, which are even more advanced than inkjet printers. But look at the very vivid colors that you can get. Another thing about giclées I want you to know, when they're done on canvas, you will think immediately that it's a painting. But you need to get your loop out, and you need to look, and you're going to see those dots of printed color and those dots of color applied as opposed to the strokes. And that's going to what's going to tell you the difference between a giclée and an original work of art, whereas a giclée is a printed work of art. It can be on canvas or it can be on any number of forms of paper. And finally, one last giclée. Well, we've done it again. We've run through 50 slides in less than an hour. I have a minute or two here. I hope some of this has helped you with your identification. You can always just refer back to it, and that's because you can go to the archives and you can find every show that's been on BCTV now for the last 8 to 10 years is right there. Here's our contact information, the Renaissance Auction Group. Our website is www.auctionhouse.com. You can email me, bill@auctionhouse.com. Give me a call. I answer my phone 7 days a week from 9 in the morning till 9 at night if I'm available, which obviously I can't be available all that much. All that time I wouldn't get anything done. And you can join us on Facebook and see a lot of what's going on with our auctions on Facebook. Now, how can you support BCTV? Because if it wasn't for BCTV, I wouldn't be sitting here talking with you. You can make a one-time donation by visiting the website, bctv.org. You can schedule a recurring donation by visiting the website, bctv.org, meaning once a month, whatever. You can make a year-end donation for tax purposes, or you can include BCTV in your legacy giving. And for more information this year, you need to contact our acting director, Ms. English Bradley, as our executive director, Heather Adams, is on a one-year sabbatical working on an exciting project that I hope you will learn more about soon. Well, that's it for tonight, folks. As always, I want to thank you for tuning in, for watching our show, but thanks most of all for supporting Birch Community Television. Birch Community Television is the only multimedia platform, local, regional multimedia platform that brings you shows about the things you love and the places you care about by the people you know. That's Berks Community Television, BCTV, Berks County's voice to the world. Thanks for tuning in. We'll see you next month.
All That Stuff on BCTV is supported by the Renaissance Auction Group.